Hi everyone, Bill Duvendak here with the monthly astrological preview video for July 2023. As you see, I've got a different setup here, so I hope you enjoy it. And let's get started, shall we? Now, July is going to be pretty different than June, but in a lot of ways, it's going to be very, very similar. With June, we had a lot of T-squares and grand crosses, so there was a lot of pressure in the air. There was a lot of stress, a lot of tension, and a lot of urging for changes. July shifts. So what we see in July is less emphasis on T-squares and grand crosses, but the emphasis on making internal changes is still there and even heightened. The reason all this is important to say up front is because beginning with technically the last day in June, but practically July 1st, we've got Neptune stationing retrograde where it will stay until December 7th. Neptune is the planet of meditation, mysticism, being inspired and therefore inspiration, metaphysics. And when it goes retrograde, it tells us it's a good time to break bad habits that you might have and negative behaviors. So it's more the emphasis on going within to figure out what needs changed, why, and how you're going to do it. Now, also on that day, we have the first grand trine of the month. A grand trine is a very positive, supportive, but dormant aspect pattern. And when it's in the element of fire, it tells us that more energy is going to be at your disposal. You might find optimism is more common than not. You also might find that you're really flipping busy. After all, fire is motion. This grand trine is happening between the moon in Sagittarius, the Venus-Mars conjunction in Leo, and Chiron in Aries. So a lot of this motion, a lot of this energy is going to have to do with when you are emotionally invested in projects. So if you're just going through with a project and you're like, yeah, I don't care, then this grand trine in fire is probably going to manifest as a short temper or irritation. But if it's a project that you're actually excited about and you want to do, watch to make more success than you thought possible. Also on the first, we have the Sun conjunct Mercury in Cancer, so it would be wise to watch your words. People might get more offended easier than they normally do. You might also find that you can bring a lot of compassion to a situation through the words that you use. Another aspect pattern that is present in the first, we're only one day into the month, but there's two dominant aspect patterns and the stationing retrograde of Neptune that really set the tone. This second aspect pattern is a yod. For those of you that may not know, a yod is a Hebrew letter, and it basically is the letter representing spirit, the divine fire, the divine spirit within us. Now, this is happening between the Sun-Mercury conjunction in Cancer, Jupiter in Taurus, the Moon in Sagittarius. So what this really means, and I think this is very interesting, is that now is a time that you might feel like you're blessed. Now is a time where things might come together, specifically when it comes to how you use your communication skills in a tender way to achieve expansion on the physical plane while not restricting your freedom. So embracing your spirituality from a very loving perspective is the theme of the yod in this case. And also on the first, we have the Sun in Cancer trining Saturn in Pisces. So it's a good time to make religious changes. It's a good time to make spiritual changes. It's a time when you might see the karma that you're settling up in your immediate family and your home life and how it ties into your overall spiritual journey, as is indicated by Saturn in Pisces. For those of you that do ritual magic, this is a good time for spiritual initiations. Now, on the second, we've got that moon in Sagittarius squaring Neptune in Pisces. So you may find that your emotions need more control and greater focus. You might also find that if you spend a lot of time daydreaming that day, it's going to work against you. On that day, we also have Pluto retrograde in Capricorn, sextiling Neptune retrograde in Pisces. Both of these are slow-moving outer planets, so this aspect is going to be in play for months. A sextile is a gently positive, flowing relationship between the bodies involved. So what that means is now is a good time to take your spiritual vision and bring it down into physical results to improve the quality of your life in an overall sense. So what this means is if you really have a cause that you want to stand up for, this is the time to put it into motion. If you look at your life and say, it's a good life, but it's not in line with my spirituality, then when you go to line the two up, it's going to happen easier than you might think. We also have the Sun conjunct Mercury in Cancer continuing, but that is sextiling Jupiter in Taurus. So you may find that communication in that very tender, loving way brings you prosperity and the expansion of consciousness in the physical world. We also have a square to Chiron in Aries coming off of that Sun-Mercury conjunction. And this tells us that even though you might be tender with your words, your wounds are going to be triggered. These wounds have to do with a sense of self and a sense of well-being. And I point this out because the irritation of the wound is going to be short-lived if you do it right, which means, of course, detachment is a good thing to do. Also on that day, we've got the Venus-Mars conjunction in Leo squaring Uranus in Taurus. So on July 2nd, it would be wise to be careful with what you say online, if not avoid the internet entirely. On the 3rd, we've got the full moon. The full moon in Cancer. It's been called that way for a long time because the sun is in Cancer. I point that out because I've seen a growing trend among people that I used to respect saying it's the full moon in Capricorn, and that's just not true. It's the full moon in Cancer with the moon in Capricorn. In addition to that, though, there's a cardinal T-square aspect present. A T-square, like I mentioned earlier, is a very challenging aspect pattern, and this one is happening between the Sun-Mercury conjunction in Cancer, Chiron in Aries, and the Moon in Capricorn. So the major theme here is too much emotions. Your emotions clouding your judgment. Maybe you say something harsh, and when somebody says something harsh back to you, you feel slighted when in reality you're getting a dose of your own medicine. Another way to look at this is in conversation, your intuition may cause you to speak before you think about it, but that intuition is on point. So you probably should say it. It's just how you say it is the question or the issue. The 4th quiets down a little bit with a moon conjunct Pluto retrograde in Capricorn. So your emotions might be deeper than normal. They might be stronger than normal. Your temper might be shorter if you're emotionally out of sorts. But whenever you have the moon in Capricorn like this, it's a good time to get mature. It's a good time to grow up. It's a good time to simply focus on what you need to do for you and let the energy transform you. Coming up on the 5th, we've got Mercury in Cancer squaring Chiron in Aries. So through communication, you might find wounds are triggered. You notice how that this is a theme for about 3 or 4 days at the beginning of July. Communication triggering wounds, either in yourself or in others. That theme is going to come up repeatedly through the month. At the beginning of the month, it's more challenging, but towards the end of the month, things get straightened out quite a bit. Also on the 5th, we've got the moon in Capricorn, sextiling Chiron in Aries. So it's a good time to heal. And the way to heal is by realizing that you don't have to be a victim to your wounds. You can be a victor. You should be a victor if you're doing it right. Anywho, we've also got that moon in Capricorn squaring Jupiter in Taurus. So you might find that your stubbornness prevents you from having prosperity and manifested success in the physical world. And all of this activity tells us that there's still going to be that pressure present that was there at the beginning of the month. It's just going to be not as intense. On the 6th, we've got Mercury in Cancer, sextiling Uranus and Taurus. Just a couple of days prior, I said that it's a good time to avoid the internet. Now on the 6th, it's a good time to jump on there. It's a good time to make the connections that you need to make to get things done. Now, the moon in Aquarius on that day is opposing the Venus-Mars conjunction in Leo, so you might find romantic situations are strained. You might find that you're emotionally detached, but others are not, and that creates problems. You may also find that you are more emotionally engaged in things, but people take offense to that because it's not about them. You see, the Aries? Interesting. I'll listen to an aria later. The Aquarius energy is the energy of the group. The Leo energy is the energy of the self. So the conflict that comes up whenever you see an Aquarius-Leo opposition is the conflict between doing what's best for everyone versus doing what's best for you. So ego is a major player in this. And on this particular day, the tension may be in your romantic relationships, or it could be that you are detached with that moon in Aquarius and it works against your creativity, or maybe you're too emotionally connected to your creative projects. On the 7th, the sun in Cancer is trining the moon in Pisces, so it's a good time for spirit work. It's a good time for emotional assessment and figuring out how to move forward. We also have the sun in Cancer on that day squaring Chiron in Aries, and that's going to last about a week, which means your family, your immediate home life may trigger your wounds, or perhaps your limits as you see them prevent you from emotionally opening up to others. So there are a couple of dangers that are going on there on the 7th. Now on the 8th, we've got the moon conjunct Neptune in Pisces, which means meditation's gonna be easier. It's gonna be easier to work with spiritual themes. Your creativity is going to be stronger than normal. Any work you do on the astral plane is going to be stronger than normal. But with the moon conjunct Neptune, it might be too much of a good thing. And you might get carried away in your creativity to the neglection of yourself and the physical world you live in. This is also saying be careful with inebriation and intoxication because you could overdo it without realizing it. And for those of you that suffer from depression, this is a day when the depression might be stronger than normal. Now, that same conjunction is also trining Mercury in Cancer. So with all of that going on with your creativity, with your meditation, with intoxicants, you may find one of the better ways to deal with that is by communicating with your loved ones and your immediate family. The 9th brings Mercury in Cancer opposing Pluto retrograde and Capricorn. So you might find discretion is the better part of valor. Watching your words would be advisable, as would seeing where you're immature and you need to grow up to the next level of maturity. Also on that day, Uranus in Taurus is squaring Venus in Leo. So again, watch your communication online, and specifically when it comes to romantic interactions or interactions with the opposite sexual orientation. Uranus in Taurus is not just the internet though. It's also random things happening from what you eat and your diet. So if you were going to take a chance on eating a new food, I would avoid doing it on the 9th. If you're thinking that you need to cut back on your high cholesterol foods, but today is not going to be that day, no, today should be that day where you cut back. It doesn't matter what your lower toxic ego says. You got to make the smart choice, and we all know that. This is just a reminder. Now, on the 10th, got to get the coffee. On the 10th, we have Mars moving into Virgo, which is trining the north node of the moon in Taurus. Mars in Virgo tells us that now is going to be a good time to get the let out in the workplace, the daily workplace. You're going to find more energy there. You might find some work projects that you've been focusing on that have been stuck are now unstuck. You may also find that by addressing the workplace, you're actually creating a lot of spiritual growth. The north node of the moon is our north pole star as we navigate life from a spiritual perspective. And when it's in Taurus, it tells us that now is the time to focus on living our spirituality as opposed to talking about it. The Mars in Virgo trine to it is saying through the workplace, you can accrue spiritual success if you focus on practicality and manifesting results. Also on the 10th, we've got the moon conjunct Chiron in Aries, so you might become painfully aware of your limits. You might also see where your mind is screwed up from some instance in the past, and things that people say to you might throw you off your game if you're not prepared. Now, following Mars moving into Virgo on the 10th, on the 11th, we have Mercury, communication and adaptability, moving into Leo. So you may feel like the 11th is all about fun. It's all about talking with friends, hanging out with friends, working with your creativity, and that's all well and good. But that placement is squaring the north node in Taurus. So it's the classic lesson of don't have too much fun, or keep your playtime limited and still focus on what you need to do in your daily life. Now, we've also got the moon in Taurus on that day, and it's conjunct Jupiter, meaning that this is a good time to listen to your intuition because it can open the gates for prosperity. Now is a good time to listen to your intuition to create manifested change in your life. But the moon conjunct Jupiter also tells us that if you've been shedding pounds, this is a day when they might catch back up to you, especially if you don't adhere to your diet and your workout routine. We've got that same moon in Taurus trining Mars in Virgo, though, and that will stay that way for a few days. And this just drives the point home that I was saying just a few seconds ago about it being a good time to focus on the workplace and getting things done in your professional life and your career. On the 12th, we've got the moon conjunct Uranus in Taurus. So be careful that strangers on the internet don't trigger your emotions. You would also find it smart to watch what you eat that day. And that same conjunction is squaring Venus in Leo. So Venus in Leo is very playful energy. It's very creative energy. It's a lot of fun energy. And when the moon conjunct Uranus and Taurus is squaring it, it's saying that there might be a conflict between doing what you were educated to do versus doing the spontaneous thing. And that same moon Uranus conjunction in Taurus is sextiling or working well with Neptune in Pisces retrograde. So this is a good day, specifically this day, to break bad habits. If you're emotionally invested about doing it, you're going to find that it comes easier to you, especially if there is a spiritual reason why you're doing it. The 13th, we see the north node of the moon move into Aries. So this is a good time to focus on the new cycles you want to put in place that have to do with your spiritual growth. The moon is in Gemini and it's sextiling Venus in Leo, so it's a great time to get creative. you might want to take a chance on that lotto ticket. This is a good time to communicate with your romantic partners and just have some fun and let it all hang out. But that moon in Gemini is squaring Saturn in Pisces, which reminds us it can be too much of a good thing. And if you pay attention to variety on that day, you might miss the point, or you might miss the spiritual lessons that are showing up at your door. So denial is to be avoided on the 13th. Also on that day, we have a mutable sign T-square, which is happening between Mars in Virgo, the moon in Gemini, and Saturn in Pisces. So you can see that this is all about the work-play balance and how distractions work against you. You see, this is something that's been talked about for several centuries now, which is the fact that if you're nothing but eclectic, taking a little bit from every spiritual path, that's fine. But you're never going to get the deep mysteries of the universe solved because you lack the discipline, the dedication, and the devotion. So therefore, on the 13th, you may see that you're spread too thin spiritually. You got all kinds of interests, but there's no substance, which means you have no substance. So the lesson, or the way to work with this mutable sign T-square, is to practice the idea of resurrection, transformation, reinvention. And, you know, ask yourself, what one spiritual system of beliefs do you adhere to above all others? And if you say there is none, you're lying to yourself, because there is one. It might not manifest itself every day. You might have to listen to your intuition to figure out what it is, but there is one. And honestly, you know, if there's not, yeah, you might be lying to yourself, but then that's a problem. Because you should find one. No tree grows without a trunk. So where's your trunk? Or do you just not care about growing? Also on the 13th, we have Pluto in Capricorn squaring the north node of the moon. So you may find that your transformation brings up spiritual issues and spiritual problems you've been putting off dealing with. So it's not so much challenges as it is your attention is being drawn to what you need to focus on spiritually. And on the 13th, we've got that lovely Venus in Leo trining the north node of the moon in Aries. So the way forward spiritually is through your creativity, through fun, through romance, through good luck and good fortune. Now, the 14th brings the sun in Cancer, sextiling Uranus and Taurus. Earlier in the month, I was talking about watching what you eat because of that Uranus and Taurus and some of the aspects that were going on with it. On the 14th, don't worry about it. Eat what you want. Drink what you want. Take your fill. Eat what you will, to paraphrase the good book. Also on that day, we've got the moon in Gemini, sextiling Chiron and Aries. So it's a good day to talk to people in order to heal your own psyche. See, that's key that not a lot of people talk about. Sometimes little conversations about your personal problems solve major headaches. What I think is interesting is with the rise of chat AI, you don't have to talk to a real person. Discretion is the better part of valor. You shouldn't always air dirty laundry, but talking to an AI chatbot to help you figure out some kind of psychological healing that you need, that's genius. I love it. Of course, I kind of like technology. On the 15th, we've got the moon in Gemini, sextiling that Venus in Leo, which we just talked about. That same moon in Gemini is squaring Neptune in Pisces. So you might spread yourself too thin and it gets you into trouble because you're too scattered and not paying attention. Or maybe you're engaged in the superficial when you should be engaged in the internal and spiritual. That same moon in Gemini is sextiling the north node in Aries. You notice that reoccurring theme. I'm not going to go over it again here. And that sun in Cancer is squaring Chiron in Aries. So your immediate family and your close loved ones may be really good at triggering your insecurities and wounds on the 15th. On the 16th, that Mars in Virgo comes back up and opposes Saturn in Pisces. So you may find that if you're focused on work, you miss some spiritual opportunities. If you're focused on spirituality, you miss some work opportunities. So find the balance. Keep your eyes open for opportunities when they present themselves, and do your best to find balance between the two. Mercury in Leo on that day is squaring Jupiter in Taurus, and that's going to last for several days. That tells us that the more you say I, or me in personal conversations, the more it's going to work against you for prosperity and the expansion of consciousness. Or perhaps it is that the more you focus on creativity and play, the less you focus on work, and that's a bad thing. But it could also mean you're so focused on work that you're irritated, you don't get a chance for playtime. This also means you might have to put romance on the back burner to focus on work, or if you put romance on the front, then understand that the work is going to suffer on the back end. The 17th brings the new moon in Cancer. So it's all about new beginnings and cleansings that have to do with your home. So it's a good day to clean your house. Your close loved ones may play a larger than average role, and you can start new cycles with them. And that new moon is sextiling Uranus in Taurus and trining Neptune retrograde in Pisces. So long story short, with the sextile and a trine there coming off of that new moon, this is a fantastic day for spiritual initiations, specifically the spiritual initiations that have to do with living your spiritual values and principles. I've talked about this at great length in a number of places, but the gist of it is that if you say that we are all one, then you're not at liberty to say we're all one, except that person or except that group of people. No. We're all one. It's a bitch, isn't it? Logic. It's our friend. You can't be a hypocrite. That's saved for less developed people than the ones watching this. That new moon is also opposing Pluto in Capricorn. So you might find you have to choose between focusing on the career versus focusing on the family and the immediate friends. The 18th is nice and quiet. And on the 19th, we've got Mercury conjunct the moon in Leo. So it's all about playfulness. It's all about creativity. It's all about fun. It's all about romance. It's all about good fortune. And both of those are trining Chiron. So if you have any experience with using art as therapy, this is a good time to do it. If you have been wanting to focus on your spirituality in order to heal your psychological wounds, this is a good day to do it. On the 20th, we've got that Sun in Cancer opposing Pluto in Capricorn. So watch your temper. Watch out for accidents, especially if you are emotionally off. If you're transforming through the workplace, remember that the workplace and the home life are not mutually exclusive. One feeds the other. I was just reading an interview with a best-selling author who's got a book that's coming out or just came out, and it addresses illusions that people have about career success. And one of those illusions is that your work life and your personal life are separate. That's an illusion. It works against you. They're interrelated. So if one's screwed up, the other one's going to be screwed up. If you get a major boost in one area, that's going to bleed over to the other. So to think that they're separate, that's just not true. And on the 20th, it's a good day to test that theory. Now, also on that day, we've got the Sun in Cancer trining Neptune in Pisces. So it's a good day for meditation. It's a good day for mysticism. It's a good day for religion. And Mercury in Leo is squaring Jupiter in Taurus. So watch your words. You may be in a prime spot to create a lot of prosperity and consciousness expansion on the physical plane. And then you open your mouth and you insert foot. That's the kind of thing to watch out for there. On the 21st, we've got the moon conjunct Mars in Virgo. So you might be in full blown work mode, but if someone distracts you, your temper might be shorter than normal. You may also find that if you hurry through projects in your workspace, that it works against you. On that day, we also have the moon, that moon conjunct Mars in Virgo, trining Jupiter in Taurus, which drives home the point. It's a good day to focus on work. It's a good day to focus on your long-term goals. It's a good day to focus on discipline and stability. Mercury in Leo on that day is trining Chiron in Aries. So it's a good day to use creativity to heal those psychological wounds. And that same Mars in Virgo that we talked about is opposing Saturn in Pisces. That's going to last for about 3 or 4 days. And that tells us that basically from the 21st until about the 25th, you may have to put work first and let all the ritual work and the spirituality and creative stuff sit on the sidelines until you're done. So it's all about prioritizing what you need to do over what you want to do. On the 22nd, the sun moves into Leo, so it's about to be Leo season. Chiron in Aries stations retrograde. One of the themes, we're already to the 22nd, one of the themes that we've been talking about this month is wounds being triggered and either being in a spot where they get triggered and you have to reassess them, or the aspect saying that it's a good time for healing. 22nd is going to test you on how you've applied the first 21 days of the month. If you've been ignoring a lot of what I've been saying, then you can expect the 21st, 22nd, and 23rd to be pretty shitty. If you've been working with what I've been talking about, then this is a time when you're going to get tested to see if you've really learned what you think you've learned, or if there's something else there to learn. Whenever Chiron stations, it's all about the wounds. And Chiron has been in Aries for a while now, so that's going to continue. And these wounds are psychological. They have to do with your sense of being or sense of self. On that day, the moon in Virgo is opposing Neptune in Pisces. So here again, you may have to choose between focusing on the workplace versus focusing on your spirituality. And really, it's up to you. That's one I can't really give you any insight on. What's more of a priority? Just make sure if you focus on spirituality, you still get the work done. If you focus on the work, then understand that sometimes spirituality and spiritual work has to be put on the back burner for a bit. Also on that day, and this is big, Venus stations retrograde in Leo. The reason this is big is Venus only retrogrades approximately every 2 years. So it's been a bit before we had it last time. The trite traditional analysis of Venus retrograde is that exes from your past will come back up to address and all of that happy crappy. But it's not just romance. Personal relationships may come back up from your past to address. And these relationships might be ones that have to do with your creative projects and your creative pursuits. This also means it's a good time to review how you spend your money when it comes to playfulness. So maybe you're spending too much money on art supplies and not enough on electricity. Or maybe you're spending too much money on lottery tickets and not enough on food at the supermarket. A few different ways to interpret it. But it's a time for review of all things Venusian. And yeah, people from your past might come back up. But if you've learned your lessons, you're going to be able to handle things very carefully and very well. Now, that same Venus in Leo is trining the North Node of Aries, which tells us that this whole Venus retrograde cycle, which is going to last about 40 days or so, hidden secret there, is going to be good for your spiritual growth if you take the initiative and be proactive. The 23rd brings that sun in Leo opposing Pluto retrograde in Capricorn. So watch out for your ego getting in the way of personal transformation. Maybe your humor in the workplace is not appropriate on that day, or somebody takes offense to it when otherwise they'd blow it off. So kind of watch your words in your career. On that day, Mercury in Leo is squaring Uranus in Taurus. So watch your words on the internet, and you might want to avoid taking chances with your diet. The 24th brings a moon in Libra, and that is opposing the Chiron, now retrograde, in Aries. When Chiron is retrograde, and it's going to be that way until December, it's a good time to practice the axiom of physician, heal thyself. And when the moon in Libra is opposing us, it's telling us that what you may have to do is prioritize which is more important, getting along with people or healing yourself. Which is more appropriate? Being the one that wants everything to look nice, or being the one who says, I don't care how things look, I got to work on me. Mars in Virgo on that day is trining Jupiter in Taurus. So it's a good day to focus on just the daily grind and working towards your long-term goals. And another aspect pattern known as the Yod that we talked about earlier in the month comes back between Venus retrograde in Leo, Neptune retrograde in Pisces, and Pluto retrograde in Capricorn. Now, we're to the 24th, and I want to take a quick moment here to talk about the fact that here we are, July 24th, there's six planets retrograde, and it's more or less going to stay like that for a couple of months. My test to you, it's not really a test, but it's something I want you to pay attention to, is to see how much coverage that gets on social media. There's no rhyme or reason to people shit posting memes saying, all these planets are in retrograde, holy fuck, holy fuck. There's that many planets in retrograde for half the goddamn year every year. You're trying to tell me you're going to cherry pick some as more important than others? Get educated. You obviously don't know astrology. When we have this many planets retrograde, which we do every year, it means we are now coming into the part of the calendar year where we go within and review ourselves. There is nothing negative about this. It's not doom and gloom. If you want doom and gloom, listen to Typo Negative. So, my challenge to you, it's not really a challenge, it's something fun. See how much attention these six planets in retrograde get from all your friends that are posting on social media. And if they don't post about this, but you've seen them post about many planets being retrograde in the past, call them out on their bullshit. Just saying. And I'm available for children's parties. Name the source of that quote. The 25th brings that moon in Libra sextiling Venus in Leo retrograde, which tells us it's a good time to have fun with friends. It's a good time to do lighthearted stuff. You may have to do something outside of your comfort zone, but that's not necessarily a bad thing. Also on that day, that same Venus retrograde in Leo is trining the north node of the moon in Aries. So by having fun with your friends, you're actually creating a lot of good spiritual stuff going forward. Who'd have thought fun would be spiritually fulfilling and healing? Hint, only the intelligent. The 26th brings a moon in Scorpio sextiling Mars in Virgo. So it's all about focus in the workplace. It's all about business. And I don't mean your own personal slice of life, how you live business. I mean making money, business, career, daily work, job, occupation, and keep your plans to yourself. I've always found the best time to let someone know what you're doing is after you've already done it. Also on that day, we've got Mercury conjunct Venus retrograde in Leo. So this specifically is a day when people from your past might come back up. This is also a good day to embrace your creativity. So see how the emphasis is on the work life, yet creativity in the process. Who says work can't be fun? It should be fun if you're doing it right. If you're not having fun at your job, get a new job. And on that day, that same moon in Scorpio is trining Saturn in Pisces. So it's a good day for spiritual initiations. It's also a good day to reassess your spirituality. Scorpio corresponds to occultism specifically, but not only, ceremonial magic. And Saturn being in Pisces is all about karma held over from previous lifetimes. So this is a good day to do all the rituals, do all the spells, do all the things, and you will get exactly the kind of day you deserve. Now, the 27th is all the fun stuff. The six planets in retrograde that I just mentioned earlier, this is when you'll begin to notice them because all the stationing periods will be done. And the moon in Scorpio is going to be opposing Uranus in Taurus. So you might find that you are too focused on that day, or maybe you're focused, you're in your groove, you're getting things done, and then some random unexpected thing happens in your physical world and it throws you completely off your game. So be open to adaptation. Understand that sometimes if the unexpected comes up, you just gotta deal with the unexpected, even if internally you're throwing a fit. The 28th sees that sun in Leo training the moon in Sagittarius. So it's a good time to just bust your ass and get stuff done. More energy is available to you then, and you might feel more closely connected to divinity. And Mars in Virgo is training Jupiter in Taurus. So it's all about manifesting money. It's all about producing physical results in your daily life, in the physical world. And it's also telling us you may be too over the top in the workplace. And it's not that you're trying to be, you're just so excited about stuff that it intimidates others. It happens. Or maybe you're so confident it intimidates others. The 29th, we have a grand fire trine. We talked about that earlier in the month. This one's happening between Venus retrograde in Leo, the moon in Sagittarius, and Chiron retrograde in Aries. Since two of the three points are retrograde, it means this grand fire trine is specifically about your connection with divinity and feeling spirit in inhabit you. And then the 30th follows that fire grand trine up with an earth grand trine between Jupiter in Taurus, the moon in Capricorn, and Mars in Virgo. So for the 29th and the 30th, we go from internal review and assessment for spiritual connection on the 29th into, okay, now that you did that work on the 29th, how are you bringing that down into physical results on the 30th? Because if you're not, there's a problem. So quick recap, I generally don't do these, but I want to do it here. Venus is going to be retrograde Leo from July 21st, 2023 to September 4th. Neptune retrograde in Pisces is going to be that way from July 1st, 2023 to December 7th, 2023. Chiron retrograde Aries is going to be happening July 22nd, 2023 to December 28th, 2023. So the first one to direct again is going to be Venus, then Neptune, then Chiron. Oh, and by the way, in case I didn't mention it, there is Mercury retrograde on the horizon. It's just not right now. Thank you to Adam Knox and the Cult of You for this platform. I love doing these things. I hope you enjoy the new setup. There's a teaser here for the Bishop's Library project coming out on YouTube very soon. And make sure you're following along with the Halls of Tarot daily tarot readings. Monthly horoscopes will be on the website. Daily horoscopes are still going to be up on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. And I guess that's about it. There is a masterclass project in the works, so watch for it. Adam's been doing a great job with it, and we're going to have some fun with it myself, too. So until we chat again, may we all receive blessings of good health, prosperity, and success as we move forward in the next month of our retrograde fun lives. Ciao.
I've always felt a little different, a little uneasy between regular folks. A bit of a dreamer, a lost cause, a little non-ordinary, some would say. I think I've always just been this way. My mother said I was special, my father thought I should be feared. But I knew that witchcraft coursed through my veins the first time I tasted the lips of the goddess inside the rain. Yes, I'm a witch, it's true. And sure, we are the ones who believe in the beauty of nature, who believe in the things science, absent of art, cannot explain, who instead of religion would have romance. And sure, you may think we have lost our way, when in the world of predictable things we have such unfamiliar things that we would like to say. But maybe, in a world so cold and alone, a little unfamiliar is exactly what is needed to show us the way home.